this is Pastor Aaron, and I have been on a series in the book of Acts for a very long time, and we are going to be dealing with Acts 29 today. You might say, wait a second, I thought there was only 28 chapters in the book of Acts. Well, we're concluding the book of Acts by talking about what it is that we are called to do as a continuation of the book of Acts. So Acts chapter 29, as we're talking about, are really what is written on your heart and on mine. The gifts and the callings of God that we've seen displayed in the book of Acts are now written and they're placed in you. The Great Commission that was at the end of the gospel message is one that is to take place and continue until the Lord returns. And we ask that today, as you listen, that you would take to heart the gifts, the callings of God in you, and the Great Commission, that we would go out and do the acts of the apostles, that we would continue what they began. We would continue what Jesus began. We would continue what Abraham, as the promise of the Father, was fulfilled in Christ and then given to the body, given to the church, given to the body of Christ to continue until he returns ultimately to establish his kingdom that is in heaven. Now we will be able to be a part of that. And so we want to just ask that today, as you listen, that you take it to heart. It's not for somebody, it's for me, it's for you. And so let's take this to heart personally today. I also want to just thank you for watching Crossfire, being a part of this ministry, and allowing us to fulfill the gospel message by taking the gospel, taking truth to other people and even to other lands. And so I want to thank you who support this ministry in prayer. You support this ministry by coming and being involved, and many who support that are out of the area, maybe even out of the country, and they're able to support financially to see the gospel message continue. I want to thank you, and we want to continue and increase what's happening, and thank you for helping make that possible. I hope you enjoy this last message in the series on the book of Acts. You can live large when you put God in charge. Through the last year, there's been a few breaks that we've taken. We took the summer off, but in over a year, we've been on Acts, going through it verse by verse, chapter by chapter. Sometimes we do 3 weeks for a chapter, and sometimes we do three chapters in a week. But we've made it through. All we have left is this last Acts chapter 29. You say, well, but if it's not there, how are we going to preach on it, Pastor? Well, we're going to preach on it because we're going to look at all the other scriptures. And what it does is it directs you to this. What is the divine mission of God in you? You see, let me explain to you. The gospel, the writer of this portion of scripture was Luke. Luke wrote the gospel according to Luke, and then he wrote Acts. Now, is all that debatable? Everything's debatable. There's always somebody willing to argue something. But I do believe with all my heart, and this is just a personal belief and not something I've shared it earlier in the series. I believe that this was a preparation for the trial of the Apostle Paul. Now, the reason I believe that is there's multiple reasons. I'm not going to get into all of it. But what I can tell you is if you're going to read just two books in the New Testament, I would probably, if you're going to read one, I'd say read John. If you're going to read two, I'd say probably read Luke and Acts. If you're only going to read two, I'd say you're an idiot. So, you know, I'd probably try to read the whole thing, you know, and just start somewhere. But I want to encourage you to understand that there is a great understanding and fix to the book of Luke and Acts together. Here's what we find. So in the book of Luke, what we find is an explanation of how Jesus came and fulfilled the old covenant. And in the book of Acts, we find Jesus ascending into heaven and sending his spirit and allowing to work through each and every single one of us. That is the heart of God concerning you and I. So that's where we are, but what comes next? See, there's no real big period on the end of the book of Acts. Paul, you know, he hasn't went to trial yet. We don't know all the facts there. It just becomes history and what some folklore of what happened to Paul and how. We do read Timothy, and some think it was before, some think it was after the book of Acts. But what we do know is this. The book of Acts was a history book, and it didn't end there. It continued with lives that have brought us the gospel to this day. And it doesn't end with you. It's never been over. It's never been finished. It will end when Jesus returns, and then we'll have eternity. That's it. Folks, I want to tell you, you are still writing the pages of the book of Acts, the history of God working to bring men and women throughout time into a place of eternity, life, not just existence, life. Information has to become application. Sorry, I don't have notes for you today. I encourage you to take some. The good thing is we only have to hit 3 points today. The bad thing is I went to bed at 8 o'clock. I didn't go to bed. I got in the shower at 8 o'clock this morning because I wanted to add an additional 9 points to my three. So I can go anywhere. As long as I get the first three, we're good. But you may not want to miss the ones I stayed up to 8 o'clock in the morning for. Number one thing that we want to address today is that your mission, if you choose to accept it, hey, at least we're not shaken, right? I mean, just saying. Your mission, your seed, you'll understand that more in a minute. Your seed should affect the world. It should affect others. Sometimes we don't quite understand what that really looks like and what that really means. But Matthew chapter 28, verse 18 makes it pretty clear. And Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, "All authority is given unto me unto heaven and earth." Now let me just say to you that when people hear that, I get questions like, well, a good God is in control of everything. Everything happens by God's design and purpose. And because of that, God's allowed evil things to happen to good people. Evil things do happen to good people, folks. Evil things happen to innocent people. That's why Jesus came, because we are already condemned. Sin was already in the world, and Jesus was here to fix it. He was offering life to people who would accept it. Some won't. All authority is given, and I'll be honest with you, he said, "I go to my Father so that authority can reign throughout the world. I go to my Father so that I can give you the things you need. I can implant in you seed. I will give you a mission, the Great Commission that we're reading here, that all could come to a knowledge of Jesus Christ." And Jesus came and spoke to them, "All authority is given into heaven and earth. Go. Go to church." Now, is that what it said? Go to work. Go give your money. He didn't say all that. He said, "There, go. Therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I'm going to be with you." Just like he was with Joshua, just like he was with Moses, he said, "I'm going to walk with you to the very end of the age." Go. Go. "Well, but I'm really busy." See, we've been given a lot of information. You come here, you get information. It doesn't do you any good until it becomes application. I can give you information, but I can't give you application. You get to apply it. Until you apply it, it's just information. Until you respond to it, it doesn't bring life to you or to others. Today, you're going to be Acts 29. And tomorrow and the next day, what will it say? Retired? Disabled? Depressed? Discouraged? Or overcomer? Empowered? Believer? Healer? Proclaimer? What's it gonna say, folks? What's your story say? Because the book of Acts is not written in one place. It's written every place. It's written in you. You get to finish the story of the new covenant. You get to finish it. Your mission will affect others to the end of the age. And he'll be with you. He can be with you because in the book of Acts, he said, I ascended that I could send my spirit, that seed would become one seed, becoming many and residing within each and every one of you. What does that really mean? This very message today only takes effect through you. It means nothing. It dies in you or it lives in you. It will die in you today. You will take it and you will walk out of these doors and it'll go dormant in you, or you'll walk out of these doors and you'll water it and you'll feed it and you'll cultivate it. If you wait till next Sunday, it'll die. See, today I can plant a seed. Really, God plants a seed by his word, through his word. He plants a seed, and then you get to do something with it. What are you going to do with it? Going to kill it? My son, we went to Coastal Farm and Home, and we were in there to buy some poison to kill some grass. Buy some parts for my sprayer. And we'd walk past some seed. And my son was like, oh, seed. $40 later of money I didn't have, I got seed, and I don't even plant stuff. But I did what every good man will do. I went home and said, give this to your mom. And he convinced her that they should plant stuff. And she convinced me that I should till. And I convinced her that we had chickens and I didn't need to till. We can just shovel. Seeds aren't going to do good in a package. They're going to have some fertilizer. They're going to have some nutrients. They're going to be planted and watered and cared for. What are you going to do with what you get today? Because it's meant to change the world. What are you going to do with your life? Oh, it's almost over. Glad Jesus didn't say that 3 years before he died. What if he'd have given up 3 years before? What if he'd have given up days before? What if he'd have given up hours before? But he didn't. He saw it to the very end. See, this message takes effect by your application and your testimony. It's what you do with the word of God that's planted in you. With what God's already done in your life, with the testimony and the story that he's already begun in your life, it's what you do with it. Let me just tell you, CR, Celebrate Recovery, great example of taking the word of God and people planting and nurturing and watering each other together. My children learning and knowing Hebrew because they come on Wednesday nights and Chuck and Marlene teach them incredible things. Heart of David, discipling, not just playing an instrument, not just being involved in spiritual warfare, but discipling. Hands of Hope, feeding people that can give them nothing. We're not after people that have much. We're after, how can we give to you? It's not what we can get. What if our attitudes changed about how can I give? How can I love? How can I reach out? Instead of, what do I get out of it? Our home groups tonight, some will show. Creating relationships, developing, becoming dynamic, growing, and making disciples. See, if the Great Commission says we're to make disciples, let me ask you a simple question. Who are your disciples? Who are you spiritually leading, watering, nurturing? We have a whole world who needs Jesus. This church is full of outreaches and ministries and opportunities. But who are your disciples? A family who have been in a program of ours, we don't tout it, we don't give names, but one of our programs called On Your Feet just bought their first house. Went from drug addiction, amen, bought their first house. But let me tell you something. We now have two homes. We now have two homes, one for men and one for women, just sitting kind of waiting in flux because we have one problem. We have one problem. I have the house and I have the people who need to be in it, but I don't have anyone willing to give their life that is ready. Oh, I have people who will be like, oh, pastor, I'll do it. But your life's a wreck. If I put you there, and I'm a little early in my notes for this, but if I put you there, the house would crumble and I would be held responsible before God. You've got to be proven. The Bible makes that clear. 2 Timothy. You got to be proven. You have to have a track record. You have to have a commitment. Does it mean you'll be perfect? No. None of us are. Number two, the mission, should you accept it? Should affect your family. Who's your family? Who's your neighbor? Matthew 7:24, we know the story, but let's read it. Matthew 7:24, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many who say in that day will say, Lord, Lord, we have prophesied in your name. We've cast out demons. We've done many wonderful works. We're a pastor's kid. We go to church every Sunday. We're amazing. And Jesus says, depart from me. I don't know who you are. Why? Because it's not about what you do. It's about who you are. It's not about who you know. It's about who you are and who you are in Christ. It's about if you have the implanted word of God and you're cultivating it, or really you're allowing God to cultivate it. See, when you allow God to cultivate his word in your life, it brings forth fruit and you live a life that affects not only the world, it'll affect your family. But listen to what it goes on and says. And I will declare unto them that I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. Verse 24. Therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them will be likened unto him who is wise and who built his house upon a rock. And the rain descended and the floods came and the winds blew and the boat and beat upon the house. And there's no boat. And it did not fall, for it was founded upon the rock. Who's the rock? Jesus. Jesus. But everyone who hears these sayings of mine and does not do them will be like the foolish man who built his house on the sand. What did he do? What did they have in common? They both built a house. I see people build a house every day. They build a family. That's what that means. They created a family. They got people around them. They began to support one another. They built a house. And folks, I want to tell you something. I see people do that every day. Now, if the period's right there, we're all good. If there's a period right there, we're golden. Because if there's a period right there, then it says, those who built a house on a rock, it stood. And then there was those who built on sand, and it's good. You know why? Because sand is really what? It's a whole bunch of little rocks. So we should be fine. I mean, really, it doesn't matter how you do it as long as you build a house. Is that what it says? Well, Pastor, I'm going to make half you mad at me. You're old fogey. We have to have sex to know if we're compatible, and we have to live together to know if we can live together. The economy is different. God understands. You know what? Do you know what building is all about? It's about whether you're going to do it God's way or your way. That's what it says. Are you doing it God's way? Are you doing it your way? You're both building a house. And thank God, not everybody, their house is destroyed before it's done. But I'm going to tell you, I love you enough to tell you. I've built on enough of my house on sand to tell you, don't build your house on sand. Well, if I go out with them, they'll come to know Jesus. Don't build your house on sand. It's not what he said. Well, I think God understands. Don't build your house on sand. But Pastor, we built it. We are so much closer to the ocean than anyone else. It is beautiful. This summer has been amazing. Now I feel the love that I've always needed from a man. I've done it my way. Listen to what it says. And the rains descended. The floods came. And the winds blew and it beat on the house and it fell. And great was its fall. You may have your whole house built on sand, or maybe you just have an addition and you're like, well, okay, until it drags the whole house in. It depends on who's in that addition when it falls, folks. Maybe your children, they might be staying in the summer house. They might be staying in the addition that was built on sand that you justified in your actions, that you destroyed. Done it. I know. You build it on sand. When the storm comes, what was so beautiful is destroyed. Who is that? It's family. Folks, your mission, the seed, what God has planted inside of you. We've read what Jesus did. We've read what the apostles did. Now it's your turn. The seed is in you. The seed is planted in you now. And what do you do with it? It's going to affect the world. It's going to affect your family. But until it affects you, it won't affect positively anyone. Number three, your mission, your seed has to affect you. James 1:19 says, so then, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath, for the wrath of man does not produce the righteousness of God. Therefore, lay aside all filthiness, overflow of wickedness, receive the meekness and implanted word, which is able to save your soul. Be doers of the word and not hearers only. Deceiving who? You. Me. The Bible says the very elect can end up being deceived. And you know what the hard part about deception is? You don't know it. You think you're good. How would I know if I'm deceived or not? He wrote this whole book about it. Oh, but Pastor, I think God under, I mean, you really, God loves everybody. You bet he does. He loves them enough to tell them the truth. And he does it in love, and he gave his life, and all he asks you to do is ask you, are you willing to give yours that others may know? Are you willing to not just give your life, but live your life? You're Acts 29. The seed's in you. What are you going to do with it? What am I going to do with it? He said, either do what he says or don't. Listen, 21 says, be doers of the word, not hearers only, deceiving yourself. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man observing himself, his face in a mirror. For when he observes himself, he goes away and immediately forgets what kind of man he is. But he looks into the perfect law of liberty and continues in it and is not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the word. This one will be blessed in what he does. Which one's loved? All of them. Which one's blessed? The doer. If anyone among you thinks he's religious and does not bridle his tongue, he deceives his own heart. This one's religion is useless. Pure and undefiled religion before God and the Father is this: visit the orphans and the widows in their troubles, and to keep oneself unspotted from the world. Colossians 1:19 says this: for it is pleased the Father that in him all the fullness should dwell, and by him to reconcile all things to himself, by him, whether things on earth or things in heaven, having made peace through the blood of Jesus. And you, who? You. Because see, the mission, the seed, doesn't work unless it starts in you. Because people are looking at your life, your testimony, your success and your failure, your repentance and your humility. And you were once alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now he is reconciled in the body of his flesh through death to present you holy and blameless and above reproach in his sight. Who does all that? Jesus does. What do? Accept it, walk in it, be led by his spirit. People say, yeah, but I think God understands. Let me just tell you a little secret. If God says go that way and you go that way, how are you going to be blessed? Because the blessing's that way. If you were digging for treasure and God said, dig here, and you dig over there, how are you going to find the treasure? Dig deeper. Dig harder. That's religion, folks. The problem is there's no blessing at the end of religion. But in a relationship and obedience to Christ, you don't have to dig very far and you find the blessings of God. You're going to have to be patient. You're going to have to endure. You have to do God's will. But you'll find it. How many people give up on God because they're digging in the wrong spot? Because they just wouldn't listen. They did it their way. I just couldn't sing it again. You're welcome. If indeed you continue in the faith, grounded and steadfast, and not moved away from the hope of the gospel which you heard, which was preached to every creature under heaven, and which I became a minister of. He says, you'll find the blessing of God, folks. And you know what? So will your family, and so will the people around you. You're Acts 29. You've got implanted seed. What are you doing with it? I'm not trying to make you feel guilty. I just want you to look. What are you doing with the seed that's already in you? God loves you, but if you've asked him into your heart, there's a seed planted within you. What are you going to do with it? Oh, don't get me wrong. It's not about do's and don'ts. It's about obedience, yes. But it's not about a list of do's and don'ts. That's not Christianity. It's about relationship with Jesus. It's about pleasing the one you love. Mission is not adding something to your schedule. Like, okay, pastor, fine. What do you want me to do? I'll be an usher. Well, that's mission. We're going to be successful. Your heart's in this. Because it's not about what you do, folks. It's about where your heart is. See, your mission is born out of love. The seed was implanted out of love. And if you're going to love like God loves, his love will be birthed inside of you. There's brotherly love, and then there's agape love that just doesn't care what it gets back. It loves. I don't do this job because I want to. No, don't get me wrong. I love what I do. But it ain't worth it. It just ain't worth it. I do this job because God has placed a love for the city in my heart that's way beyond me. He's placed a love in my heart for you. And I want to tell you, you want to give up when they just walk away, when they reject you, when they say mean things about you, when they don't need you anymore. You didn't measure up. But can I tell you, I receive what I need from Jesus. When I don't want to do this anymore. But when I receive what I need from Jesus, and the seed that's planted in me begins to grow, and I get to love you regardless of who you are, regardless of what you do. There's a love in my heart, and it ain't me. It's Jesus in me, the one that gives hope and sight to the blind. Pastor Aaron just gives, all I really care about is myself. But Jesus in me loves you. And every day I have to choose to live by the flesh and cultivate the flesh or cultivate the spirit. And when I cultivate the flesh, I don't like any of you. But when I cultivate the spirit, I love every one of you. I used to say it this way. I got two dogs. I got a flesh dog. Anyone ever come in contact with their flesh dog? It's a dog. And you know what? I got a spirit dog. And they're both there. Do you know who wins in my life? Whether I love you or love me? Care only about what is good for me, or I care about what's good for you. Do you know who? It's which one I feed. I feed the flesh, it wins. And I care about me and not you. I feed the spirit, and it wins. And I love like Jesus. It's no different than you than it is for me. What are you doing with the seed that's in you? Who are you feeding? Mission is not about being busy. It's not about adding to your schedule. It's about what grows inside of you. I got 4 minutes. I can hit these last 9. Church is not mission. It's a product of mission. If you go to church to be a Christian, you failed. Done. Especially because most of the Christian people are a bunch of hypocrites. They're not acting like Jesus. They don't even fit the definition of Christian. Most of us don't. But the church is born out of the seed that's planted in you. It's born out of the Jesus in you. It loves and is in unity out of the seed that's in you. We are not the church because we put a name over the door. We're a church when we begin to love like Jesus loves. Not like him, but allow him to love through us. Number four, your mission is born out of the love of Jesus. John 3:16. Mission has a purpose behind the love of God. Let me see. Mission is the purpose behind the love of God. God says, listen, I can plant this in your heart. Religion creates a mission or a seed with a purpose, but it's not born out of love. It's born out of works. It's born out of how good I am. It's born out of something I can't accomplish. Out of love comes genuine mission, the right purpose, the right reason. And God wants to plant that in your heart. But where's the seed? Where and what does the seed look like? Is it just sitting there dormant? Is it still in the package? Number five, divine mission has a cause greater than itself. Has a cause greater than itself. I'm not going to read the story, but in 1 Samuel chapter 17, the story of David and Goliath. David's up and he's got his sheep and he goes down to feed his brothers. I'm making this really short. He goes down to take lunch to his brothers. As he's down there, he sees this giant. Everyone's afraid of the giant. He looks at him and says, who in the heck is this guy defying the armies of God? His brother becomes very condescending to him and says, who do you think you are? Go take care of your stupid sheep. And David says, wait a second. Do you not see that there's a cause? Folks, do you not see that there's a cause? Do you not drive past here and see that people need Jesus? Do you not look around and people are hungry to be loved and be cared about? I can't meet everyone's needs. I've got Jesus in me. I gotta start with my family. I can do the best I can. I can operate in my calling, but I'm not the body of Christ. We are the body of Christ. We are it together. He says, do you not realize there's a cause? David goes, we know he puts the armor on, he goes and defeats Goliath. Why? Because God put something in his heart, and God nurtured it, God watered it, and David just walked in obedience. It was God's work in David, just like it's God's work in you. Six, divine mission has timing and preparation. Story of Esther. For such a time as this, there's timing, there's preparation, there's patience. It's needed. Number seven, every divine mission has opposition. I don't have to teach on that very long, do I? No. Saul was relentless. In chapter 19, two chapters down, Saul went after David. 20 years, he tried to kill and destroy David, the anointed king, the one that was to take his place. And he was jealous and angry. Folks, can I just tell you, you have opposition. Every divine mission is going to have opposition. It's not always going to go the way you want it to go. It's not. You're going to learn. You're going to grow. The seed's going to get stamped out once in a while. But you know what? If it's taken root, it'll come back. They might pull your weed or grass or fruit. Let me just tell you, if you've taken root, it's coming back. Every divine mission requires humility and purity. Isaiah 6:1 says, in the year King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on his throne, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Remember that? And Isaiah said, I'm not worthy.
And the seraphim came and took a coal from the altar and touched it to his lips. He purified him. And he said, I'm not worthy. He showed humility. And you know what the beautiful thing was? The divine mission also demanded an answer. There's a call of God in your life right now, today. You're Acts 29. There's a call of God in your life today. Well, but I think God understands my situation. Yes, and your situation is people will die and go to hell because you only care about you, and that is not the implanted word of God. He says it takes obedience. The divine mission is this. It's going to take an answer. For Isaiah, it was, Lord, send me. Who will go? I'll go. Send me. And at the end, it says there's always a remnant. At the very end of this little scripture, I don't have time to share it all with you. It says, and there'll be a stump. After the tree is cut down, there'll be a stump left. It's also talked about in John 12. And there'll be a stump, but out of it will grow a shoot. Isaiah 11:1 talks about that. And there shall come forth a rod from the stem of Jesse, a branch that grows out of this rod. And the Spirit of the Lord will rest upon him. Who's that? Jesus. Oh, the children of Israel, that's been cut off. But you know what? It's not done. Because out of it has grown the Messiah, Jesus. And those who will believe on him, even it be a portion. And you know what it goes on to say? And it says, and the Gentiles will receive him. Praise God, that's us. Maybe you might be part of the Jews, that's fine. But either way, we have a choice. That's the good part. We have a choice. But to great fruit. To be the one that the branches that grow, that produce fruit, that other people might live, folks. You got to remain in the vine. And this is what he said, and that day will come up out of the land of Egypt. Folks, we're called to come up out of the land of Egypt. We're called to lead people from the land of Egypt. That's what the ministries of this church are about. That's what you should be about. We find people in bondage. We help them come out of the land of Egypt. I do it. You do it. Together, folks, we will literally can change this city and affect this world. Ten, every divine missionary has to be chosen. And every branch has to be chosen. Are you willing? God wants to choose you. Are you willing? He wants to nurture and he wants to allow that seed to take root and grow. Are you willing? Number 11 is every missionary, every mission has a mandate. Isaiah 61:1 says, and the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he's anointed me to preach good tidings to the poor. And he sent me to heal the brokenhearted. You know, that looks different to everyone. Every one of our callings, every one of our purposes are different, but we all complement each other. We're to love people. To proclaim liberty, freedom to the captives, and open the prisons to those that are bound. It's a mandate. It's a mandate that God, that Jesus gave when he left in the end of the Gospels. It's the mandate that Jesus gave when he said one seed will become many, and he said the promise of Abraham will be fulfilled in Acts chapter 1. Number 12, the last one today. Listen carefully. Let the seed of God grow in you and take root today. Galatians chapter 3. This is what he said, Galatians chapter 3. Jesus as the seed, not seeds as in many, but seed as in one. Here in a few weeks, we'll be celebrating the day of Pentecost where the one seed, Jesus, ascended into heaven and he said, and I'll give you my spirit, and you'll become many seeds. And you'll do what I can do even more because I go to my Father, and I'm going to operate in you. I'm going to cultivate the seed within you. I'm going to cultivate love within you. You're going to begin to grow the fruit of the Spirit, and things are going to change. Life is going to be different, not just for you, but for the world. Not just for you, but be into your family and your house. But it has to start in you. What are you going to do with the seed? You that are watching by TV, around the world, they got people around the world who watch. Last week, someone from Norway, that was it. People in the Philippines, people in Africa. Here around the city, and you sitting here. What are you going to do with the seed that God has entrusted in you? Well, God loves me, then love others. Well, God's really helped me, then help others. This church is not about being your seed. It's about a place where the seed can grow together. It can complement each other. It can bring nutrition to our city. That's what the family of God is about. But what are you going to do with your seed? Say thank you or be obedient? With every head bowed and every eye closed, I ask this simple thing. It's simple, yet very profound. Do you know Jesus today? First thing is this. Do you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior? If you don't, the first thing you need is to say, Lord, could I have the seed? It comes with mission, but it starts very personal with you and Jesus. Lord, could I receive you into my heart, into my life? Would you give me your spirit? And today, if you'd like to know Jesus, you can simply raise your hand and we'll pray with you. We have people who love to pray with you before you leave. Is there anyone here that would say, Pastor Aaron, I need Jesus in my heart. I want the seed of God in me. Is there anyone here that would just slip your hand up and say, that's me? Amen. Amen. I see that hand. Any others? Amen. I see that hand. Any others that would just simply say, I need that in me? Anyone else? Second thing I want to ask is this, and in just a minute I'm going to ask the prayer team, be ready to run up here, folks. How many here, the seed in your life, your relationship with Christ, you don't want him to say, you've done all these things, but I don't even know who you are. How many of your seed is only for you? You eat your seed. It doesn't grow to anyone else, really. It's not changing any other lives. And today you say, Lord, I ask that you would, in me, not what I expect out of anyone else, in me, let your seed grow. If that's you, I'm going to ask you to raise your hand. If you just say, I need the seed of God to grow in me. I want it to grow in me. Amen. Amen. Lord, I pray right now for those that are raising their hand, many raising their hand saying, I need this seed to grow. Lord, I ask you begin to infuse them with power. That Lord, they won't leave here and let this be dormant. They're gonna leave and they're gonna nurture and they're gonna water and they're gonna listen to you and they're gonna read your word and they're gonna put to action, application. They're gonna be Acts 29. Lord, I ask this in your name. Prayer team, would you come? Would you come? As quick as you can, prayer team, come. Lord, I pray right now for those who raise their hand to accept Christ, Lord, those who want to walk further, Lord, those who want to grow deeper, they want roots that remain, they don't want to be that shifting sand that causes the house to collapse and affects their whole family and those that they love, but Lord, instead, that they would begin to love even greater, and they build on a rock, and when the storms come, others would run into the house and be saved. they would see that, Lord, it's not them, it's you. Let them be a vessel of honor. If you're here today and you say, I just need someone to pray with before I leave, could we all stand to our feet? I'm going to ask if you would to slip out there. There's some of these here. Maybe you raised your hand for one thing or another. Maybe you want to accept Christ. Maybe you just say, I can't leave here until I've prayed with somebody. These people are just simply want to pray with you. They want to help you. Amen. Lord, I thank you for each and every one here. Lord, let this day, let this end of this series be one of power. One where, Lord, the roots start to grow deeper. And the fruit becomes not only good for themselves, but Lord, more importantly, for their families, for the people around, that they would, together, they would eat of others and others would eat of them, but they would all taste you and walk in unity.
You know, as we close this series on the book of Acts, you know, living large doesn't mean I get a whole bunch of stuff, because we as Americans have enough stuff. Living large means that we get a greater effect on our community, on the people around us, in our family, of the gospel message, that we get to make a difference, that there's purpose, eternal value, eternal purpose to our lives. If today you're looking at this and saying, man, I want God to do something in me. I need God to do something in my life. There's people that would love to talk with you. They'd love to pray with you. They'd love to help you. I want to encourage you to call the number at the screen or get a hold of us. We'd love to partner with you in discipleship. We have a thing online that we would love you to get. It's called the Purple Book. It starts walking you through the basic gospel discipleship, just basic Bible. It's not a denominational book. It's very non-denominational. It's very much just basic Bible, no agenda. We'd love you to be able to start walking in that. Maybe you're a believer, you've known Christ, you know your Bible really well. And you say, Pastor, I'd like to connect and be a part of what Crossfire is doing here in the land. We'd love to have you partner with us. Go to our website at mycrossfire.com. Check out what's happening. See how you can be involved. And if nothing else, you can be involved by prayer and by financial sacrifice. We just ask that you would help us continue what God has started and be able to increase. And as you plant seed, watch it grow, that people would be able to receive the word of God, that they'd be able to receive the fruit of the gospel. And we love that message. That's what we preach. That's what we talk about. That's what we're about. What God has done on the cross manifested into the hearts and lives of people through the word of God, Jesus, the word. I hope that you've enjoyed this series on the book of Acts. I hope it blesses you. I want to encourage you to call someone else, let them download it, go to our website. They can listen to the entire series on the book of Acts. And I believe that it'll cause you to grow in your faith. It did me, did our congregation, and I believe it can you. And so thank you for being a part of Crossfire Ministries.
Crossfire World Outreach Ministries is supported by faithful monthly contributions from viewers like you. Please take time today and make your tax-deductible gift to Crossfire World Outreach Ministries, 942 28th Street, Springfield, Oregon, 97477, 541-686-3473, or find us on the web at mycrossfire.com.